بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه من والاه. تترجم ولا ملتها؟ طيب،
بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. So continuing on with what the author rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, he's proceeding now to explain the hadith of Usama that the people of doubts use. He says, and as for the hadith of Usama radiallahu anhu, then indeed he killed the man who was claiming Islam, because he thought that he, meaning the man, was only claiming it out of fear for his own blood and wealth. And it is obligatory to hold back from the man who manifests Islam until something which opposes this becomes evident from him. And with regards to this, Allah has revealed, O you who believe, when you go out on a journey in the path of Allah, fighting your enemies, then verify, and you do not rush into killing those people whose affairs are unclear. Meaning, as the Shaykh he explains here, meaning proceed with caution and verify. So this ayah proves that it is obligatory to hold back from him and to verify. So if after that something which opposes Islam becomes apparent from him, then he is to be killed according to his statement, then verify. So if he were not to be killed once he had said it, then there would be no purpose in verifying.
معنى هذا الكلام أن حديث أسامة ليس فيه دلالة على عدم قتل من قال لا إله إلا الله مطلقا، وإنما يدل على أن من قال لا إله إلا الله ننظر في حاله، إن أتى بما أمر الله وترك ما نهى الله وأتى بالإسلام فهو مسلم له مع المسلمين، وإن أتى بخلاف ذلك بأن دعا غير الله أو كفر أو كذب فإنه يقتل. والآية الله عز وجل يقول: يا أيها الذين آمنوا إذا ضربتم في سبيل الله، يعني قاتلتم، فتبينوا، يعني انظروا هل أسلم أم لا. ومعنى تبينوا أي تثبتوا من إسلامه. شيخ الإسلام محمد بن عبد الوهاب يقول: لو لم يكن للتثبت والتبين معنى لما أمر الله به، لأن قوله فتبينوا أمر، أي فتبينوا هل هو مسلم أتى بما أمر به من الإسلام أم لا زال واقعا في الكفر والشرك. نعم.
So the Shaykh is saying that again explaining this hadith of Usama رضي الله عنه, he said that the hadith, it does not contain evidence to say that the person who says the Shahada or the person who pronounces the Shahada is to never be killed at all. That is not what the hadith is establishing here. Rather, we have to look, after the person says the Shahada, does he actually implement Islam? Does he bring what is required from Islam? In that case, then he is preserved. His wealth, his life is preserved. However, if he comes with something which is clearly in opposition to Islam, then that ruling is taken upon him. Yani he can be killed. He said, and this is why in the ayah it says, تَبَيَّنُوا, yani to verify. Verify from what? And verify that he is upon Islam. He said, so Shaykh al-Islam, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he mentions that if the person were to not be killed at all after pronouncing the Shahada, then there would be no purpose in verifying. So the statement, verify, means to verify after someone has pronounced the Shahada, to verify that he is indeed upon Islam.
قال وكذلك الحديث الآخر وأمثاله معناه ما ذكرناه أن من أظهر التوحيد والإسلام وجب الكف عنه لأنه يأخذ حكم المسلمين، كل المسلم على المسلم حرام دمه وماله وعرضه. قال وجب الكف عنه إلى أن يتبين منه ما يناقض ذلك. والدليل على هذا أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أقتلته بعدما قال لا إله إلا الله، وقال أمرت أن أقاتل الناس حتى يقولوا لا إله إلا الله. هو فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الذي قال لأسامة هذا وقال أمرت أن أقاتل الناس هو الذي قال في الخوارج أينما لقيتموهم فاقتلوهم لئن أدركتهم لأقتلنهم قتل عاد، مع كونهم أي الخوارج من أكثر الناس عبادة وتهليلا وتسبيحا، حتى أن الصحابة يحقرون أنفسهم عندهم وهم تعلموا العلم، وهم أي الخوارج تعلموا العلم من الصحابة، فلم تنفعهم لا إله إلا الله ولا كثرة العبادة ولا ادعاء الإسلام لما ظهر منهم مخالفة الشريعة.
And then the author continues by saying, and likewise, the meaning of the other hadith, and it's like, just as we have mentioned, that it is obligatory to hold back from whoever manifests Islam and Tawheed, unless something which nullifies that appears from him. And the Shaykh, he mentioned the likes of the hadith, that every part of the Muslim, or everything from the Muslim, is prohibited upon the Muslim, his life and his blood and his wealth and so on. And then the author continues by saying, and the proof for this, or the proof for that, is the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the one who said, did you kill him after he said, La ilaha illallah, referring back to the hadith of Osama, and the one who said, I was commanded to fight the people until they said, La ilaha illallah. He was the same one, yani the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the same person who said about the Khawarij, the group, a deviant group who declared the Muslims to be non-Muslims and they rebel against the rulers. He said about the Khawarij, wherever you find them, then kill them. And if I were to reach them, I would certainly kill them with the killing of Ad. And this was despite there being the people who engaged most in worship. And they said, La ilaha illallah. And they said the tasbih, subhanallah. And the companions looked down upon themselves compared to them, yani compared to the Khawarij and their actions. And the Khawarij gained knowledge from the companions. Yet, when opposition to the Sharia appeared from them, their statement, La ilaha illallah, the Shahada La ilaha illallah, did not benefit them. Nor did the abundance of worship, nor did their claim, nor did their claiming Islam for themselves.
هذا الكلام من شيخ الإسلام محمد بن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله تعالى يبين أيضا أنه ليس في الحديث حجة لهم، لأن معناه في نفس الحديث أمرت أن أقاتل الناس حتى يقولوا لا إله إلا الله ويقيموا الصلاة ويؤتوا الزكاة، فإن فعلوا ذلك عصموا مني دماءهم وأموالهم إلا بحق الإسلام، فمن أخل بالتوحيد فبحق الإسلام نقتله عند الحاكم الشرعي ويستحق الكفر والقتل. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما يقول شيخ الإسلام قاتل الخوارج، مع أن الخوارج كما وصفهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الصحابة على مكانتهم يحقرون صلاتهم إلى صلاتهم وصيامهم إلى صيامهم وقراءتهم للقرآن إلى قراءتهم، ومع ذلك أمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بقتل الخوارج وهم يقولون لا إله إلا الله ويسبحون إلى آخره. وقوله رحمه الله تعالى مع أن الخوارج تعلموا من الصحابة، أراد بقوله تعلموا من الصحابة أي جلسوا بعض المجالس فسمعوا من الصحابة، ولكن الخوارج انفردوا عن الصحابة وفهموا الدين على عقولهم متعالمين. ولذلك الشيخ العثيمين الشيخ النجمي وغيرهم من أهل العلم يذكرون الخوارج أنهم من أمثلة المتعالمين الذين لم يفهموا الدين ويظنون أنهم فهموا الدين. نعم. وإلا من جلس إلى الصحابة واستفاد منهم وأخذ منهم العلم والإيمان لا يكون حاله كحال الخوارج، وإنما أراد الشيخ رحمه الله أنهم جلسوا بعض المجالس واستفادوا بعض العلم. نعم.
Now, so similarly to to summarize what the Sheikh is saying here, he's again explaining that this hadith, the hadith of Osama, and also the hadith that I was commanded to fight the people until they say La ilaha illallah, these hadith do not contain a proof for the people who have fallen into shirk. Rather, it contains a proof against them. He said, for example, in the hadith that I was commanded to, that I have been commanded to fight the people until they say La ilaha illallah, in the hadith itself, the Prophet ﷺ continues to say that if they perform the salah and they pay the zakat and so on, that their blood and their wealth will be protected from me, except by the right of Islam. And he said, and this part here explains, except by the right of Islam, it means that if the person falls into that which opposes Islam, and the Sharia has ordered us to, or has ordered the ruler to kill such a person, such as the apostate, then he is to be killed. And as he said, the Sheikh said that this is for the ruler, the Muslim ruler. He said also the Khawarij. The other example mentioned here is that the Khawarij, that there were people who, the companions, when they compared their actions to the actions of the Khawarij, the apparent actions, they belittled themselves in front of the actions of the Khawarij. However, we have been ordered to fight these people. He said, explaining that the Khawarij learned from the Sahaba, he said what this means is that the Khawarij, they lived at the time of the Sahaba, and they sat in some of their sittings, and they learned some of the issues of their religion from the Sahaba. However, they did not continue with the Sahaba. Rather, they would learn some of it, and then they would go by themselves, and they would leave the Sahaba, and they would end up as pretenders to knowledge, muta'alimin, someone who pretends to have knowledge, or someone who claims to have knowledge, when in reality they do not. He said, and this is the problem with them, that they understood the religion after they left the Sahaba, they understood the religion with their own understanding, not with the understanding of the companions. So, and he said, he mentioned some of the ulama, such as Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen and Shaykh ibn Najmi, rahimahumullah ta'ala, and other than them, they cited these people as an example of the muta'alimin, the people who claim to have knowledge or pretend to have knowledge. Shaykh al-Qat Amr al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Qatl al-Khawarij, al-Hakim inshallah. And also just to clarify that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he commands us to fight the Khawarij and to kill the Khawarij, that this is for the Muslim ruler, this is not for everyone to do by themselves.
قال الشيخ رحمه الله تعالى وكذلك ما ذكرناه من قتال اليهود مع كونهم يقولون لا إله إلا الله قاتلهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقتال الصحابة بني حنيفة وكانوا يقولون لا إله إلا الله وكذلك أراد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يغزو بني المصطلق لما أخبره رجل أنهم منعوا الزكاة حتى أنزل الله تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن جاءكم فاسق بنبأ فتبينوا يعني بني المصطلق أتى رجل وأخبر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنهم منعوا الزكاة فهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يقاتلهم لكن جاء بنو المصطلق ومعهم الزكاة فتبين أن هذا الرجل كذب على بني المصطلق فأنزل الله عز وجل قوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن جاءكم فاسق بنبأ فتبينوا قال وكان الرجل كاذبا عليهم قال وكل هذا يعني كل هذه الأدلة يدل على أن مراد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في الأحاديث التي احتجوا بها من عدم قتل من قال لا إله إلا الله ما ذكرناه من أنه ما لم يستحق القتل بأمر شرعي نعم.
And then the author continues by saying, and likewise what we have mentioned from and likewise what we have mentioned from the fighting against the Jews and the fighting of the companions radiallahu anhum against Bani Hanifa. And likewise he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he wanted to wage a military expedition against Bani Mustalik when a man had informed him that they were preventing or they were withholding the zakat until Allah had revealed, all you who believe, if there comes to you a fasiq, a sinful person with some information, then verify it. So the Shaykh explained this incident. He said that someone came to the Messenger of Allah وسلم, saying that Bani Mustalik had refused to pay the zakat. And because of this, the Prophet ﷺ wanted to fight them. However, the people of Bani Mustalik themselves had sent some people with the zakat to give to the Prophet ﷺ. So when these people came, when they arrived at the Prophet ﷺ, it became clear that this claim was not true, and that this person had lied about them. And this is why Allah had revealed that statement, "O you who believe, if there comes to you a sinful person with some information, then verify it." So the author continues by saying, "And this man was lying upon them." And all of this proves that the intent of the Messenger of Allah in the hadith was that which we have mentioned. Meaning that a person who simply pronounces La ilaha illallah, it does not mean that they are never to be killed ever after that. Rather, that it depends on the situation, and that if there is a right of Islam to kill them, then it can be done.
قال الشيخ ولهم شبهة أخرى وهو ما ذكر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن الناس يوم القيامة يستغيثون بآدم ثم نوح ثم بنوح ثم بإبراهيم ثم بموسى ثم بعيسى فكلهم يعتذر حتى ينتهوا إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. قالوا فهذا يدل على أن الاستغاثة بغير الله ليست شركا.
And the author continues by saying and they have another doubt, and it is that which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned, that the people on the day of resurrection will seek deliverance, they will seek istighatha, they will seek help from Adam عليه السلام, and then Nuh, and then Ibrahim, and then Musa, and then Isa عليه السلام, and all of them will excuse themselves until they eventually end up at the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. So these people who are falling into shirk, they say this proves that istighatha, or seeking deliverance from other than Allah, is not shirk.
وجه الاستدلال بهذا الحديث أنهم قالوا إن طلب الاستغاثة لم تجعل أو ليست ممنوعة شرعا, مما يدل جواز الاستغاثة وجواز يعني طلب الشفاعة من الأنبياء والرسل والأولياء.
The doubt here that they are bringing is that they say based on this hadith, seeking istighatha, seeking assistance, or even seeking shafa'a, as here in the hadith from the prophets or other than them, is allowed in the religion.
قال شيخ الإسلام جوابا على هذا الكلام قال والجواب أن نقول سبحان من طبع على قلوب أعدائه فإن الاستغاثة بالمخلوق فيما يقدر عليه لا ننكرها, كما قال الله تعالى في قصة موسى فاستغاثه الذي من شيعته على الذي من عدوه, وكما يستغيث الإنسان بأصحابه في الحرب أو غيره في أشياء يقدر عليها المخلوق. ونحن أنكرنا استغاثة العبادة التي يفعلونها عند قبور الأولياء أو في غيبتهم في الأشياء التي لا يقدر عليها إلا الله. نعم.
عندك أنكرنا استغاثة العبادة كذلك اللفظ عندك
استغاثة أكمل
لا اللفظ اللي عندك عيدة استغاثة العبادة والعبادة
ونحن أنكرنا استغاثة العبادة التي يفعلونها
عشان عندي
يعني
عندي لفظ مختلف
الاستغاثة
التي هي عبادة
من باب العبادة
أي. أنا عندي عبادة طيب so the sheikh he said continuing on that the author he says that the response to this is that we say how perfect is the one who seals the hearts of his enemies, for indeed we do not reject istighatha, seeking assistance or seeking deliverance from the creator, from the creation, and that which he is able to do or in that which they are able to do, just as Allah the Most High has mentioned in the story of Musa, so the man from his party sought help from him, yani made istighatha from him, from Musa, against his enemy. And the Shaykh continues by saying, and just as the person who seeks help makes istighatha from his companions during a war, when other than that from matters in which the creation are able to do so. And we reject the istighatha which is worship. The wording that I have here is that we reject the istighatha of servants, but as the Shaykh has in his book, we reject the istighatha, that is worship, which they make at the graves of the awliya, the servants of Allah, or in their absence in matters which none has the ability to do except for Allah.
الجواب الشيخ يقول الاستغاثة نوعان استغاثة مشروعة أو جائزة واستغاثة شركية محرمة أما الاستغاثة المشروعة لها شروط الاستغاثة بالحي الموجود القادر على فعل الشيء حي فالميت لا يستغاث به موجود فالغائب لا يستغاث به بالحي الموجود القادر على فعل الشيء إذا كان الشيء بمقدوره من دفع مال أو دفع عدو كما استغاث ذاك الذي من شيعة موسى استغاثه على عدوه طلب أن يساعده أما مثلا تستغيث أن يمدك بالولد أو أن تستغيث أن مثلا يخلق لك كذا أو يفعل لك كذا شيء لا يقدر عليه إلا الله هذا شرك هذه الاستغاثة المشروعة أو الجائزة حي حاضر قادر على فعل الشيء الاستغاثة الشركية والمحرمة الاستغاثة بالميت أو بالغائب أو بالحاضر الغائب الذي لا يقدر عليه إلا الله كأن يأتي إلى الولي الحي ويطلب منه الولد أو يطلب منه شيء بيد الله عز وجل كان يطلب مثلا علم كذا فهذا الاستغاثة الممنوعة فشيخ الإسلام بيّن لهم أن نحن لا ننكر الاستغاثة الجائزة المشروعة وإنما ننكر الاستغاثة الشركية نعم
So the Shaykh here, now he's explaining the response of Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and he says that istighatha is two types seeking assistance or seeking deliverance is of two types a type which is permissible and a type which is impermissible the impermissible type is shirk the permissible type has three conditions the first condition is that a person seeks assistance from someone who is alive meaning someone who is alive not someone who is dead Someone. The second condition is someone who is present, meaning not someone who is absent. And the third condition is someone who is able to do what is being requested. So he said that when these three conditions are fulfilled, that this is allowed. We do not reject this. However, the forbidden type or the shirk type is seeking assistance or istighatha. From a person who is dead, or a person who is absent, or a person who is unable to do something, even if he is alive and present. So he said, for example, about the issue of seeking that which is able to do, that which the person is able to do. He said, such as helping someone, as the person, as the man from the companions of Musa alayhi salam, or from the people of Musa, requested him to help him fight his enemy. He said this is something someone is able to do. A person is able to help fight. Or someone who is able to, for example, help you pay off a loan or the likes of this. He said as for the shirkiya type or the type which is impermissible, that is asking something that only Allah can do or something that the person is not able to do. Such as asking someone to provide you with a child or asking someone to bless you with something that only Allah can do. He said, so we do not reject the Shaykh al-Islam, he has explained here that we do not reject the type which is permissible.
قال الشيخ رحمه الله تعالى إذا ثبت ذلك أن الاستغاثة جائزة واستغاثة محرمة إذا ثبت ذلك فاستغاثتهم يعني استغاثة الناس بالأنبياء يوم القيامة يريدون منهم أن يدعوا الله أن يحاسب الناس حتى يستريح أهل الجنة من كرب الموقف وهذا جائز في الدنيا والآخرة وذلك أن تأتي عند رجل صالح حي يجالسك ويسمع كلامك فتقول له ادعو الله لي كما كان أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يسألونه ذلك في حياته، وأما بعد موته فحاشا وكلا أنهم سألوه ذلك عند قبره، بل أنكر السلف الصالح على من قصد دعاء الله عند قبره، فكيف بدعائه نفسه؟
And then the author continues by saying, when that is established, meaning when you have understood the two types, the type which is permissible and the type which is impermissible, then the istighatha, seeking deliverance from the prophets on the day of resurrection, is that they wish from them that the prophets call upon Allah to begin the reckoning, yani to begin the reckoning, the hisab of the people, so that the people of paradise obtain relief from the distress of that incident or that time, that place. And this is permissible in the worldly life as well as in the hereafter. And this is that you go, and here he makes an example, and this is that you go to a living righteous man. He sits with you, he listens to your speech, and you say to him, make dua to Allah for me. Just as the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do. They would ask him that during his life. As for after his death, then not at all. They would not ask him. They would never ask him for that at his grave. Rather, as the Salaf al-Saleh, the pious predecessors, refuted the one who directed his supplication to Allah at the grave of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what about the one who is making dua directly to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
هذا الجواب يبين فيه الشيخ أن الناس يوم القيامة لم يستغيثوا الاستغاثة المحرمة، ثم لم يطلبوا من الأنبياء أن يفرجوا هذا الكرب بأنفسهم، بل طلبوا منهم أن يشفعوا لهم عند الله، فالذي يكشف الكرب هو من؟ هو الله. ثم بين أن طلب الدعاء من الرجل الصالح الحي لا مانع من ذلك، كما ورد عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما جاءه رجل وشكى إليه قلة المطر، قال فادعوا الله يغيثنا، فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رفع يديه وقال اللهم أغثنا، اللهم أغثنا. وأيضا بين أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بعد موته الصحابة ما كانوا يدعونه، كما قال عمر للعباس إن كنا نستسقي بالنبي، يعني نطلب دعاءه وهو حي وقد مات، والآن نطلب منك أنت يا العباس الحي الموجود، نطلب منك أن تدعو. ثم بيّن أن الصحابة كانوا يمنعون من أراد أن يدعو الله عند قبر الرسول، ما أراد أن يدعو الرسول، لكن أن يدعو الله عند قبر الرسول، كما جاء عن الحسين بن علي لما أنكر على رجل وقف يدعو الله عند قبر الرسول، فأنكر عليه إنكارا شديدا وزجره. فيقول شيخ الإسلام محمد بن عبد اللهاب، فكيف الذي يقف عند القبر ويدعو ويسأل الرسول نفسه؟ نعم.
So the Sheikh is saying that here the author is explaining that on the people on the day of judgment they are not making istighatha, the type of istighatha which is prohibited. Rather, what they are doing is allowed. And that is because they are not seeking from the prophets themselves to remove this distress. But rather, they are seeking from the prophets to go and intercede with Allah. And this is allowed. And then he mentioned also the example that this is permissible in the time when someone is alive. This is permissible when someone is alive that you go to him and request him to make dua for you. And he mentioned that the companions, they did this with the Prophet ﷺ during his lifetime. And he mentioned a hadith in which a man came to the Prophet ﷺ during a drought and he requested him to make dua for rain. So the Prophet ﷺ made dua for rain. This is an example of them requesting this during his lifetime. He said after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, then they never did this. And he said this is clear in another narration in which Umar radiallahu anhu, he said that we used to ask the Prophet ﷺ to make dua for us for the rain. And then he went to Abbas and he said, but after he has died, we ask you, O Abbas, to make dua to Allah for the rain. He said, why? This is because the Prophet ﷺ has died. So, So we see that so after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, that they did not do this. And then he continued by saying that the Salaf, they rebuked the one who, or they rebuked the one who made dua to Allah at the grave of the Prophet ﷺ. And he said, so what about the person who makes dua? And he mentioned an example of that from a narration. And then he said, so what about the person who is making dua directly to the Prophet ﷺ? It's even worse. Now,
ثم قال شيخ الإسلام ولهم شبهة أخرى وهي قصة إبراهيم عليه السلام لما ألقي في النار اعترض له جبريل في الهواء فقال ألك حاجة؟ فقال إبراهيم أما إليك فلا. قالوا فلو كانت الاستغاثة بجبريل شركا لم يعرضها على إبراهيم. قال فالجواب أن هذا من أكمل ولا
كما تحب
أحسن لنا خفيف. قال فالجواب أن هذا من جنس الشبهة الأولى، فإن جبريل عرض عليه أن ينفعه بأمر يقدر عليه، فإنه كما قال الله تعالى فيه شديد القوى، فلو أذن الله له أن يأخذ نار إبراهيم وما حولها من الأرض والجبال ويلقيها في المشرق أو المغرب لفعل، ولو أمره أن يضع إبراهيم في مكان بعيد عنهم لفعل، ولو أمره أن يرفعه إلى السماء لفعل. وهذا كرجل غني له مال كثير يرى رجلا محتاجا فيعرض عليه أن يقرضه أو أن يهبه شيئا يقضي به حاجته، فيأبى ذلك الرجل المحتاج أن يأخذ ويصبر إلى أن يأتيه الله برزق لا منة فيه لأحد. فأين هذا من استغاثة العبادة والشرك لو كانوا يفقهون؟
And then the author, he continues by saying, and they, meaning the people who fall into shirk, they have another doubt. And it is the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he was thrown into the fire and Jibreel appeared in front of him, or he appeared to him in the air and while he was being thrown. So Jibreel, he said to him, do you have anything that you need? So Ibrahim alayhi salam, he responded by saying, as for you, yani meaning from you, then no. So the mushrikeen, the people who fall into shirk, they say that if istighatha from Jibreel, seeking assistance from Jibreel or deliverance from Jibreel was shirk, then Jibreel would not have suggested that to Ibrahim. So the response to this is that this is from the same category as preceded. Jibreel suggested, meaning that which is allowed because it is something which he is able to do. Jibreel suggested to him, yani to Ibrahim, that he could benefit him with something that he could actually do. And this is just as Allah Azza wa Jal, the Most High, he stated about Jibreel, that he is mighty in strength. And so had Allah given him permission to take the fire of Ibrahim and whatever was around it from the earth and the mountains and to put them in the east or in the west, then surely he would have done it. And if Allah Azza wa Jal had commanded him to place Ibrahim alayhi salam in a place far away from them, then surely he would have done it. And if he had commanded him to raise him to the heavens, then surely he would have done it. And this is just like a rich man who has a great deal of wealth and he sees a man who is in need. So he suggests to him, yani to the man who is in need, to give him a loan or to give him something from his wealth to fulfill his need. So the man who is in need, he refuses to take that and he has patience until Allah brings provision to him without his being indebted to anyone. This is how istighatha, an act of worship, so the Shaykh says, how is this istighatha worship and shirk? Yani how is this istighatha shirk? If they only understood.
أولا قصة جبريل ضعيفة، إنما هي من الإسرائيليات عن كعب الأحبار، ذكرها البغوي في التفسير، ليست ثابتة. ولو ثبتت فجوابها ما ذكره شيخ الإسلام محمد بن عبد الوهاب، أنها استغاثة في أمر جائز حي موجود فيما يقدر عليه، ليست استغاثة محرمة، ليست استغاثة محرمة. ثم ذكر شيخ الإسلام محمد بن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله تعالى أن هذا مثل الرجل الغني لما يأتي لرجل فقير أو محتاج يقول له خذ مال أنا أساعدك، فالفقير ممكن يأخذ المال ويستفيد منه، ولكن تكون للغني عليه منة، ويمكن الفقير يقول له لا جزاك الله خير أنا أبغى من عند الله عز وجل، ما أبغى من أحد من الخلق، ما فيها شيء. كذلك جبريل لما أراد أن يساعد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إبراهيم عليه الصلاة والسلام أراد أن يساعده وإبراهيم رفض من باب أنه يريد من الله عز وجل، فليست الاستغاثة هنا من الاستغاثة الشركية. فقال فبين شيخ الإسلام الفرق بين الاستغاثتين. نعم.
So the Sheikh, he said that first of all this story of Jibreel and Ibrahim السلام, this story is weak, it's not authentic, and it is from the narrations of Ahlul Kitab. He mentioned from Ka'b al-Ahbar, and he said that if it were to be true, that yani if it were authentic, then the response to it is as Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab has explained here. And then he went down, he skipped down to the part of the example. He said, so this is, it is istighatha which is allowed. Just as in the example of a rich man who sees a poor man and he offers him a loan or offers him his wealth, either to take it as a loan or to take it. So the poor person, this poor man, or the person in need, he has the choice. He can either take it or he can reject it. If he takes it, then the rich man will have something over him, and if he rejects it, seeking it only from Allah, then that's allowed. In either case, it is allowed. He said, so similarly, Ibrahim alayhi salam, in this story, he rejected the help of Jibreel because he wanted it directly from Allah. He said, so here, the Shaykh has distinguished between the two types of istighatha, that which is allowed and that which is shirk.
قال الشيخ رحمه الله تعالى ولنختم الكلام إن شاء الله تعالى بمسألة عظيمة مهمة جدا تفهم مما تقدم، ولكن نفرد لها الكلام لعظم شأنها ولكثرة الغلط فيها. فنقول لا خلاف أن التوحيد لا بد أن يكون بالقلب واللسان والعمل، فإن اختل شيء من هذا لم يكن الرجل مسلما. فإن عرف التوحيد ولم يعمل به فهو كافر معاند كفرعون وإبليس وأمثالهما، وهذا يغلط. أكمل ولا
أكمل؟
وهذا يغلط فيه كثير من الناس، يقولون هذا حق ونحن نفهم هذا ونشهد أنه الحق، ولكننا لا نقدر أن نفعله، ولا يجوز عند أهل بلدنا إلا من وافقهم، وغير ذلك من الأعذار. ولم يدري المسكين أن غالب أئمة الكفر يعرفون الحق ولم يتركوه إلا لشيء من الأعذار، كما قال تعالى اشتروا بآيات الله ثمنا قليلا، وغير ذلك من الآيات كقوله يعرفونه كما يعرفون أبناءهم. فإن عمل بالتوحيد عملا ظاهرا وهو لا يفهمه ولا يعتقده بقلبه فهو منافق، وهو شر من الكافر الخالص، لقوله تعالى إن المنافقين في الدرك الأسفل من النار.
And then the author continues by saying, so let us conclude the speech inshallah ta'ala with a tremendous issue, one of great importance, which can be understood from what has preceded. However, we will single it out with some speech on account of the tremendousness of this affair and the abundance of errors surrounding it. So we say, there is no differing that tawheed must occur with the heart and with the tongue and with action. So if one of these is missing, then the man is not a Muslim. Yani the person is not a Muslim. So if he knows tawheed but he does not act upon it, then he is a disbeliever, one who stubbornly opposes, such as Fir'aun or Iblis or the likes of these two. And this is something with regards to which many people have erred. They say, This is the truth, and we understand this, and we bear witness that this is the truth. But we are not able to act upon it, and the people of our land do not permit it. And the people of our land do not permit anything other than agreeing with them, and other than this from the excuses. And this miskeen, this poor person, he does not know that the majority of the leaders of disbelief are aware of the truth, and they do not forsake it except for some excuse. Just as he, the Most High, said, they purchased with the ayat of Allah a meager gain. And ayat other than this, such as the statement of Allah, those to whom we gave the scriptures recognize him, and Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, just as they recognize their sons. So if he manifests action upon Tawheed while he does not understand it, nor hold it as a creed and belief in his heart, then he is a munafiq, a hypocrite, and is more evil than the one who is a pure disbeliever. Allah says, indeed, the hypocrites will be in the lowest depths of the hellfire.
الشيخ هنا رحمه الله تعالى ختم الكلام بهذه المسألة التي تقعد لك وتلخص لك ما سبق، بأن التوحيد لابد أن يكون مستقرا في القلب وباللسان وبالفعل. ثم قال لك إن اختل بمعنى نقص أو انتقض أحدها لم يكن صاحبها مسلما. فمن عرف التوحيد في قلبه واستقر لكن ما عمل به فهو كافر معاند. فرعون كان يعرف أن الله حق، إبليس كان يعرف أن الله حق، فبعزتك رب انظرني إلى يوم يبعثون، لكن وإن آمن بقلبه أو وإن عرف بقلبه لكن لم يعمل كفر. واضح؟ فيقول الشيخ فمن عرف التوحيد ولم يعمل به فهو كافر. قال ومن هنا يغلط كثير من الناس، لأن بعض الناس مثلا عندهم الذبح للأولياء والطواف حول القبور، ويعني بل حتى يذبح له هو من الأولياء، يعرف أن هذا باطل وأن هذا كفر وشرك، ومع ذلك يقول يعني أنا أعرف أنه هذا كذلك لكن لا أستطيع أن أغير، قومي يعني يريدون كذا، ويظن أن عدم استطاعته عذر له في شركه. لا، فإن الله عز وجل كما قال اشتروا بآيات الله ثمنا قليلا، وبين أن اليهود لما ذكرهم قال يعرفونه، وأهل الكتاب يعرفونه كما يعرفون أبناءهم، يعرفون علاماته ويعرفون أنه رسول الله وأنه حق كما يعرفون أبناءهم، لأنه مذكور عندهم في الكتاب بصفته وبأحواله، ورأوها أمامهم يؤمنون في داخلهم يعرفون هذا، لكن هذه المعرفة بهذا الأمر ما فادتهم. لذلك هذا اختل جهة ماذا؟ جهة العمل. قال غالب أئمة الكفر كذلك. ثم قال فإن عمل بالتوحيد عملا ظاهرا وهو لا يفهمه أو لا يعتقده بقلبه فهو منافق. المنافقون يصلون ويشهدون أن محمدا رسول الله، ويعني للزكاة يفعلون، ويقولون لا إله إلا الله بألسنتهم، ولكن بقلوبهم لا يفقهون. قال الله في حق المنافقين إن المنافقين في الدرك الأسفل من النار. هنا فائدة أن الكفار درجات في النار، والمنافقون في الدرك الأسفل من النار شر من الكافر. لماذا؟ لأن المنافق تظاهر بالإسلام وأبطن الكفر ويخادع الله ورسوله والذين آمنوا والله خادعهم سبحانه وتعالى، فكانوا مستحقين للعذاب الشديد. فدل هذا على أن قول التوحيد باللسان مع عدم استقراره في القلب لا ينفع صاحبه، كما أن استقراره في القلب وعدم عمله بالجوارح لا ينفع صاحبه. نعم.
So the Sheikh, he said, that this is an issue, inshallah, that will summarize everything that has preceded. And that is that tawheed, it must be done, it must take place in the heart and on the tongue and in action. And if a person was to fall short in one of these, then he has fallen into disbelief. So if he knows, yani if he has understood the truth and he disbelieves, then he is someone who opposes, stubbornly opposes. And the similarity to him is like Fir'aun or Iblis. Because Fir'aun, he knew the truth, as Allah has mentioned in the Quran. And similarly, Iblis, he knew the truth, as Allah mentioned in the Quran. However, they openly disbelieved, or they refused to act. And then the Shaykh, he went on to say that some people, they say that we understand the truth, we bear witness to it, but we are unable to act upon it. He said, so some people, they, when you come to them and explain to them Tawheed, they say, yes, we agree, we understand. But they try to excuse themselves, whether they are making a sacrifice to other than Allah, or even if the person himself is the one who is being sacrificed for, yani the Shaykh or whoever, they say that, yes, we understand that this is shirk. However, the people will not accept it. The people cannot change. We cannot change the people. So they try to bring some sort of excuse for themselves. And he says that they do not understand that this excuse is not acceptable. And then he mentioned that the other people of disbelief, the leaders of disbelief, they also had some excuse, but it was not correct. Just as Allah has mentioned, they purchased with the ayat of Allah a meager gain. And he said in the other ayah, to those who we gave the scriptures, recognize him just as they recognize their sons. He said that Allah Azza wa Jalla has explained here that the people of the book, or the Jews in particular, they knew the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They knew him by his characteristics, they knew him by his signs, they knew him by seeing him in front of them, and they recognized him, and they understood that he was the Messenger who was intended. But they did not believe. They did not believe, yani they understood in their hearts that he was the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but they did not act upon it. And then he went on to say that the one who manifests action upon Tawheed, while he does not hold it in his belief, he does not believe it in his heart, then he is the munafiq, he is the hypocrite. He said, in explaining this, the Shaykh, he said, so the munafiqoon, the hypocrites, they pray, they give zakat, they bear witness, and that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, and so on and so forth. But they do not believe in their hearts. Or in their hearts, they do not understand and they do not believe. And in the ayah, Allah Azza wa Jal says, indeed the hypocrites will be in the lowest depths of the hellfire. He said, here we have a benefit, which is that the disbelievers are of different types and they are of different levels. And the munafiqoon are the lowest of these levels. And he said, that is because they openly show Islam while believing the opposite, yani disbelieving in their hearts. So they tried to deceive the people and they tried to deceive Allah. So therefore they deserved the strongest or the worst punishment. So the Shaykh concluded by saying that the statement of Tawheed upon the heart, or the statement of Tawheed upon the tongue, if it does not agree with what is in the heart and what is on the actions, then it does not benefit.
ثم قال الشيخ وهذه المسألة كبيرة طويلة تتبين لك إذا تأملتها في ألسنة الناس ترى من يعرف الحق ويترك العمل به لخوف نقص دنيا أو جاه أو مدارات لأحد وترى من يعمل به ظاهرا لا باطنا فإذا سألته عما يعتقد بقلبه فإذا هو لا يعرفه ولكن عليك بفهم آيتين من كتاب الله. يعني الشيخ رحمه الله تعالى بهذا الكلام يبين أن هذه المسألة تحتاج إلى تأمل واطلاع على أحوال الناس. فهناك من يرفض الحق خوفا من أن يلام عليه، يعني يعرف أن الحق في كذا فلا يقول به، وهذا كثير في الناس، يعرف أن الحق في المسألة الفلانية والحق مع فلان أو فلان ولا يستطيع أن ينصره، بل أحيانا يذمه و يعني يصفه بالخطأ ويصفه بالباطل، لأنه لو قال خلاف ذلك لطعنوا فيه وتكلموا فيه، فيترك قول الحق خوفا من الناس لا خوفا من الله. قال فيحتاج أن يتتبع أحوال، يقول الشيخ العثيمين فيحتاج أن يتتبع أحوال الناس ويعرفها تماما حتى يعلم من هو منافق ومن هو مؤمن إيمانا خالصا. نعم.
And then the author continues by saying, and this issue is a great lengthy issue, which will be made clear to you if you reflect upon what is upon the tongues of the people. You will see the person who knows the truth but abandons acting upon it out of fear of a reduction in the worldly benefits or status or mudara, dealing with the people or dealing with someone. And you will see the person who acts upon it outwardly but not inwardly. So if you ask him about what he holds as a creed and a belief in his heart, then he does not know it. However, however upon you is to understand two ayat from the book of Allah. So then the Shaykh went back to explain that here Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab has explained that this issue is an issue that needs contemplation. It is an issue that demands from the person that he contemplates upon the conditions of the people. And he mentioned similarly from Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala. So the Shaykh he said that some people, for example, they understand the truth, they know that this is the truth, however they reject it, or they may even speak against the truth because they fear the people.
يقول ولكن عليك بفهم آيتين من كتاب الله، أولاهما قوله تعالى لا تعتذروا قد كفرتم بعد إيمانكم، فإذا تحققت أن بعض الصحابة الذين غزوا الروم مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كفروا بسبب كلمة قالوها على وجه المزح واللعب، تبين لك أن الذي يتكلم بالكفر أو يعمل به خوفا من نقص مال أو جاه أو مدارات لأحد أعظم ممن يتكلم بكلمة يمزح بها.
And then the author continues by saying, so upon you is to know two ayat from the book of Allah. The first of them is that which has preceded from his statement, subhanahu wa ta'ala, make no excuse, you have indeed committed disbelief after you had iman. He said, so when you have certainty that some of the companions who fought against the Romans alongside the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam fell into disbelief on account of a word which they said playing or mocking or in jest, then it will have become clear to you that a person who speaks a statement of disbelief or acts upon it out of fear of loss in wealth or status or relationship with the people is worse than the one who makes it out of playing and jest.
الشيخ رحمه الله تعالى يريد بهذه الآية أن يبين لك أن الذين حكم الله عز وجل عليهم في هذه الآية بالكفر كفروا بكلمة قالوها من باب اللعب والمزاح، فكيف بحال من يقع في الكفر خوفا من نقص مال أو منصب أو مدارات لأحد، فإن كفره أعظم ممن يتكلم بها وهو مازحا، فإن كفره أعظم ممن يتكلم بها وهو مازحا. وهذه الآية لا تعتذروا قد كفرتم بعد إيمانكم، من العلماء من قال الذين قالوا ذاك الكلام كانوا منافقين. طيب قولوا قد كفرتم بعد إيمانكم أي الظاهر الذي أظهرتموه، فإنكم تؤخذوا على الكفر، كنتم مع الصحابة يحكم بإسلامكم الظاهر. ومن العلماء من قال لا، كانوا مؤمنين ويعني فوقعوا في هذا الأمر فكفروا بهذا الكلام. نعم.
So the Shaykh now he's explaining that the author, he mentioned this ayah, the first ayah, make no excuse, you have indeed committed disbelief to the end. That what is intended here is that the people who Allah Azza wa Jal has declared them to be disbelievers. He has made the ruling of disbelief upon them. It was due to a statement that they made out of mazh, out of playing or joking. So what about the person who says such a statement, yani a statement of disbelief, fearing the people? He said, no doubt that this is a worse type of disbelief. He said, and as for the ayah itself, explaining the ayah, make no excuse, you have indeed committed disbelief after you had iman. He said, from the ulama are those who say that the ayah is about or regarding munafiqeen, that everyone who is intended were indeed munafiqoon, they were hypocrites. And that the statement, after you had iman, it means after you made your iman apparent, after you had apparent iman, that now you have been called out, and now you have been ruled with disbelief, after you had been apparently believers. And from the ulama are those who say that no, rather what is intended is that some of the people actually did believe, and then they fell into disbelief due to this statement that they made.
والآية الثانية قوله تعالى ومن كفر قوله تعالى من كفر بالله من بعد إيمانه إلا من أكره وقلبه مطمئن بالإيمان ولكن من شرح بالكفر صدره فعليه غضب فعليهم غضب من الله ولهم عذاب عظيم ذلك بأنهم استحبوا الحياة الدنيا على الآخرة. إذن ولكن من شرح بالكفر صدرا فعليهم غضب من الله ولهم عذاب عظيم ذلك بأنهم استحبوا الحياة الدنيا على الآخرة. قال فلم يعذر الله من هؤلاء إلا من أكره مع كون قلبه مطمئنا بالإيمان. وأما غير هذا فقد كفر بعد إيمانه سواء فعله خوفا أو مداراة أو مشحة بوطنه أو أهله أو عشيرته أو ماله أو فعله على وجه المزح أو لغير ذلك من الأغراض إلا المكره. نعم.
And then the author, he continues on to the second ayah, the second verse from the Quran, or ayah from the Quran, which Allah Azza wa Jalla says, whoever disbelieves in Allah after his iman, except for the one who is coerced and his heart is at peace with iman.
ولكن من شرح بالكفر صدرا فعليهم غضب من الله.
Except for the one whose chest has become open to disbelief, then upon him is the anger of Allah. So Allah did not excuse anyone from these except the person who was coerced while his heart was at peace with iman. And as for other than this, then he has committed disbelief, yani meaning the one whose chest was opened to disbelief. Then he has committed disbelief, he has committed kufr after iman, regardless of whether he did it out of fear or out of dealing with the people, politically dealing with the people, out of jealousy for his homeland or his people or his clan or his wealth, or whether he did it mockingly or playingly or for the purposes other than that, unless he was coerced.
الله عز وجل في هذه الآية بيّن أن من كفر بعد إيمانه عليهم غضب من الله ولهم عذاب عظيم إلا من أكره وقلبه مطمئن بالإيمان. أكره بالقول أو بالفعل بأن يفعل شيئا كفريا أو شركيا، ولكن قلبه مطمئن بالإيمان. إذن شرطان: الأول أن يكون هناك إكراه، الشرط الثاني أن يكون قلبه مطمئن بالإيمان. فما يفعل الشرك أو الكفر وهو متقبلا له، منشرحا صدره له، لا، يكون قلبه مطمئن بالإيمان ولو قال كلمة الكفر. هذه الآية مع الآية التي سبقت توضح لك متى يكفر الإنسان ومتى لا يكفر. فإن وقع في الكفر أو الشرك قولا أو فعلا مع انشراح صدر أو عدم إكراه، دل هذا على أنه كفر. وإن وقع في ذلك إكراها مع اطمئنان قلبه بالإيمان، أنه لا يكفر. نعم.
So the Sheikh, he comes now to explain this He says that whoever falls into disbelief after having iman, then upon him is the anger of Allah, as mentioned in the ayah. Except for the one who has been coerced, except for the one who has been forced. He said that is either by statement or by action. It can be one of two things. And he said, and for this, yani for this excuse, or for the one who is the one who does not have the punishment of the anger of Allah, there are two conditions. The first is that he is coerced, he is being forced to do it. And the second is that his heart is at ease with iman, meaning that he has not accepted disbelief. His heart has not accepted disbelief. He says, so this ayah, it explains when a person falls into disbelief and when a person does not fall into disbelief.
يقول الشيخ رحمه الله فالآية تدل على هذا من جهتين. على ماذا؟ على أن الله عز وجل لم يستثني من الكافرين إلا من أكره وقلبه مطمئن بالإيمان. الأولى قوله إلا من أكره، فلم يستثني الله تعالى إلا المكره، ومعلوم أن الإنسان لا يكره إلا على الكلام أو الفعل، وأما عقيدة القلب فلا يكره عليها أحد. والثانية قوله تعالى ذلك بأنهم استحبوا الحياة الدنيا على الآخرة، فصرح أن هذا الكفر والعذاب لم يكن بسبب الاعتقاد أو الجهل أو البغض للدين أو محبة الكفر، وإنما سببه أن له في ذلك حظا من حظوظ الدنيا فآثره على الدين. أذان
إن شاء الله after the أذان. So the author continues by saying that the ayah proves this from two angles. The first is from his statement, except for the one who is coerced. So Allah did not make an exception for anyone other than the one who is coerced. And it is known that a person is not coerced in other than action or speech. As for the aqidah, as for the belief, the creed of the heart, then no one can be forced in that. And the second is the statement of Allah Azza wa Jal, that is because they preferred the life of this world over the hereafter. He said so, he stated explicitly that this kufr, this disbelief and punishment was not on account of disbelief, not on account of creed and belief, nor ignorance, nor hatred of the religion, nor love of disbelief. Rather, it was only on account of having a portion of this worldly life and his preferring it over the religion.
شيخ الوجه الثاني يبين رحمه الله تعالى أن الله عز وجل بين أن كفر من شرح بالكفر صدرا كان أيضا بسبب استحباب الحياة الدنيا. قال فصرح أن هذا الكفر والعذاب لم يكن بسبب الاعتقاد أو الجهل أو البغض للدين أو محبة الكفر، وإنما كان سببه أن ذلك أو أن لهم في ذلك حظا من حظوظ الدنيا فآثره على الدين. فدل هذا على أنه يقع في الكفر، وأن من يحاول أن يدافع أو أن يولد شبها للدفاع عن المشركين الذين وقعوا في الشرك يعارضون هذه النصوص الدالة على شرك من وقع في الشرك، وأن الأدلة الشرعية تناقضهم وتعارضهم. قال الشيخ ابن عثيمين رحمه الله تعالى وذلك أن بعض الناس يكفر لأنه يحب الكفر ويعجبه، هذا جانب. وبعض الناس يكفر لمال أو جاه أو رئاسة، وبعض الناس يكفر لينال بذلك شيئا من السلطان وما أشبه ذلك، فالأغراض كثيرة. فبين الشيخ رحمه الله تعالى بفهم هاتين الآيتين تفهم من المراد في الأدلة الشرعية بمن يقع في الشرك. نعم.
So the Sheikh continued on to say that as for the second part, the second ayah, that is because they preferred the life of this world He said, so the reason for them falling into disbelief is because they loved something from this worldly life. And meaning it was not something from belief or from creed, as the Shaykh has explained, as the author mentioned. But rather it was due to them having a portion of this worldly life, and that causing them to prefer it over the religion. And then he mentioned that some of the people, they present these doubts, or they bring these shubhat and these doubts to oppose what they have fallen into in terms of shirk and the likes of it. Because, just to summarize what he's saying, because it is clear in these ayat, so this person, he brings these doubts in order to oppose these ayat, in order to oppose, basically to justify what he has fallen into from shirk. And then he quoted something from Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, in which the Shaykh, he mentioned that the people fall into disbelief are of two types. There are people who fall into disbelief because they love this disbelief, they love this type of kufr or shirk or the likes of it. And the second are people who disbelieve not because they love disbelief, not because they love kufr, but because they love something of the dunya and they prefer something of the dunya over the religion. So by understanding this ayat, you will understand the different types of disbelief and the different types of people and how they fall into disbelief.
ثم ختم الشيخ رحمه الله تعالى بقوله والله سبحانه وتعالى أعلم، وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وآله وصحبه وسلم، والحمد لله رب العالمين. وهناك بعض التنبيهات أود التنبيه عليها.
And then the author, he concluded this treatise or this book by saying, and Allah, the perfect, the most high, knows best, and all praises for him, the Lord of all creations, and may Allah raise the rank of our messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers and companions. And then the Shaykh said that there are some issues that he would like to address after this.
أورد الشيخ رحمه الله تعالى قوله ولما لم ينقد أناس في زمن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم للحج أنزل الله في حقهم ولله على الناس حج البيت. هذه الرواية ضعيفة فأحببت أن أنبه على ضعفها.
نعم. So the Shaykh mentioned early on in the treatise that there's a part.
في طبعة ابن عثيمين صفحة 105. شرح الشيخ ابن عثيمين صفحة 105.
There's a part in the book in which the author, he mentions that as for, there were some people who did not submit to following or to performing the Hajj, and then Allah had revealed the ayah about the Hajj, the obligation of Hajj. He said that this narration is not authentic, and it occurs in page 150 in the explanation of Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen.
التنبيه الثاني نبه عليه الإمام العثيمين رحمه الله تعالى في شرحه عند مسألة طلب الدعاء من الرجل الصالح. أولا أقول أنا قبل أن أقرأ كلام ابن عثيمين، هناك مواطن وردت طلب الدعاء من الإمام حين يخطب ومن الرجل الصالح استسقاء للناس، لا مانع من هذا. شيخ العثيمين ينبه على مسألة بعد أن ذكر الشيخ رحمه الله تعالى أنه يجوز أن تأتي عند رجل صالح يدعو لك، نبه على مسألة قال وهذا حق، إلا أنه لا ينبغي للإنسان أن يتخذ ذلك ديدنا له كلما رأى رجلا صالحا قال أدعو الله لي، فإن هذا ليس من عادة السلف رضي الله عنه، وفيه اتكال على دعاء الغير. ومن المعلوم أن الإنسان إذا دعا ربه بنفسه كان خيرا له، لأنه يفعل عبادة يتقرب بها إلى الله عز وجل، فإن الدعاء من العبادة إلى آخر كلامه. فالمهم أنه أشار إلى ما نراه عند كثير من الشباب، ادعي لي يا فلان لا تنسانا من دعائك الصالح، من دعائك الصالح. لم يكن هذا من فعل السلف. فهذه فائدة عزيزة من الشيخ رحمه الله تعالى. نعم.
The second issue that he would like to point out to the Sheikh Muhammad Salih Al-Uthaymeen رحمه الله تعالى, he mentioned he addressed this issue concerning seeking dua or asking dua, requesting dua from a righteous person. So the Sheikh, Sheikh Ahmed, he mentioned that firstly there are evidences to establish the permissibility of this, such as istisqa and some of the other narrations that had occurred. Now going back to what Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen mentioned, he said that yes, this is allowed. However, a person, it is not becoming of a person. A person should not make it the norm. He should not make this a habit that he always asks someone to make dua for him. And this was not how the Salaf, Salih, rahimahumullah, this is not the action that they used to do. This is not what they were upon. They did not used to do this. And he said, is a person becoming depending on someone else to make dua for them. And it is known that a person should make dua to Allah directly, and the virtues of making dua to Allah directly, and the likes of this. And in the end, just to conclude, that this is not from the manhaj of the Salaf, and this is not what the Salaf were upon.
التنبيه الثالث مر معنا في قصة جبريل لما قال أما إليك فليس لي حاجة، وفي قصة وفي آية الحج فأنزل الله ومن كفر فإن الله غني عن العالمين، أن الأثران أو يعني الخبران ضعي أن الخبرين ضعيفان. لا يعني هذا لما يضعف أو يرد قول لعالم الطعن فيه، لأن بيان الحق ورد الباطل أمر مشروع. فما يفهمه بعض الناس أن الرد على المخطئ هو طعن في المخطئ نفسه هذا يعني منهج خاطئ، منهج لا يوافق منهج السلف رضوان الله عليهم. فقد كان الصحابة كما يقول ابن رجب رحمه الله تعالى يرد بعضهم على بعض، ولا زال العلماء يرد بعضهم على بعض. فالمقصود بارك الله فيكم أن العالم إذا أخطأ ورد الخطأ الذي أخطأ فيه لا يلزم منه الطعن فيه أو انتقاصه من حيث الرد. مر معنا قول شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية قال هذه القصة تفيد أن المسلم بل العالم قد يقع في أنواع من الشرك. فبعض الناس إذا رديت على شيخ من المشايخ خطأ يثور ويغضب كحال المتعصبين الذين نسمع عنهم في المذاهب الذين يستميتون في الدفاع عن متبوعيهم أو متبوعهم، فهذا خطأ، هذا ليس من منهج السلف، تنبهوا لهذا. نعم.
نعم. So to, again to summarize what the Sheikh is saying, he said that it has preceded before in the explanation that when we came across the story of Jibril alayhi salam and Ibrahim alayhi salam, and other than this there were some other points in which the Sheikh he mentioned that, for example, this narration is weak. He said that we need to understand something, pointing out the fact that the narration is weak, it does not necessitate that we are speaking against the author or that we are speaking against the alim who brought this narration. He said even clarifying the mistake of a scholar to clarify that this person, this sheikh, this alim has fallen into a mistake, it does not mean that we are belittling him or that we are refuting him or that we are taking away from his status. He said this is a mistake, a misunderstanding that some people have, and it is a manhaj khata, it is a wrong methodology that some people believe, that if you speak or if you mention that the Shaykh made a mistake in this issue or that issue, that you are belittling him or refuting him or the likes. He said, so انتبهوا لهذا, pay attention to this. This is not what is intended. And he mentioned that for example, the muta'assiba, the people who they have blind following to a particular madhab or a particular Shaykh, that this is something that they do, they fall into this. And he mentioned that Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he mentioned in this same treatise that an alim may fall into an issue of shirk or tawheed that he does not understand. So again, it does not mean that clarifying mistakes or pointing out mistakes, it does not mean that someone is belittling that scholar.
الأسئلة. الأسئلة.
والله أعلم. طيب. هذا سائل يقول ما الرد على من يقول ما الرد على من يستغيث بالجان زاعما أنهم موجودون قادرون أحياء. This question is asking, what is the response to someone who says, or someone who calls upon the jinn, saying that they are present, able, and alive?
الرد على هذا من وجوه. الوجه الأول أنهم أحياء موجودون نعم، ولكن هل تراهم؟ إنه يراكم هو وقبيله من حيث لا ترونهم. فإذا ما دام أنك لا تراه كيف تناديه؟ طيب ترجم.
He said that the response to this is from a number of angles. Firstly, yes, they are alive and they are present. However, you do not see them. As Allah mentioned, that they see you in a way that you do not see them. So he said, so how, if you do not see them, then how can you call upon them?
الوجه الثاني أن الأدلة الشرعية دلت على عدم التعامل مع عالم الجن والشياطين، فمن أين لهؤلاء الدليل من الكتاب أو السنة أو من فعل السلف الصالح رضوان الله عليهم أنهم كانوا يتعاملون مع الجان الصالحين وأنهم كانوا يطلبون منهم أمورا يقدرون عليها؟ لا نعلم على هذا دليلا إلا عند السحرة والمشعوذين والكهان.
He said, secondly, the legislative evidences have pointed or have established that we do not work with the jinn. He said that there is no evidence for it, not from the Quran, not from the guidance of the Messenger of Allah, not from the companions of the Salaf. He said, so where is the dalil for these people? There is no dalil other than what the magicians and sorcerers mention.
الثالث الوجه الثالث أن هذا يدخل من باب الشرك، لأن العلماء ذكروا قاعدة أنك إذا جعلت شيئا سببا لم يجعله الشارع سببا فهو شرك. أنك إذا جعلت شيئا سببا لم يجعله الشارع سببا ولا يدل عليه من عالم الناس مما تعارف عليه أنه سبب للعلاج أو سبب لأمر ما، كما يتعارف الأطباء لأنواع الأدوية، فإنه يدخل من باب الشرك. ولذلك الإسورة النحاسية قالوا شرك. لأن لماذا قالوا الإسورة النحاسية؟ لأنها تعالج الأمراض في العظام، تعين على ترك الطعام، تدفع العين. طيب هل هذا سبب؟ لا، ما هو سبب. فجعلك للإسورة سببا يدخل في باب الشرك كما ذكر هذا أهل العلم. كذلك استعمال الجان وجعلهم سبب في تحقيق بعض الأمور والشرع لم يجعله سببا يدخل في باب الشرك.
He said, thirdly, this enters into the issue of shirk. It enters into the aspects of shirk. He said that is because there is a qaida, there is a principle that the ulama mentioned, and that is that if you make something a means which the legislation has not made a means, or it is not known, it is not established, such as medicine or his, yani what is apparent, right, what is seen and heard and the likes, he said then this enters into shirk. And if someone makes something a means and it is not known or it is not mentioned in the sharia to be a means, then this enters into shirk. And he mentioned, for example, that from the example of medicine, that there is a bracelet of nuhas, copper, I believe, copper, that some people, they believe that this bracelet is able to help, or it is able to cure some ailments or the likes. However, this is not established medically. So this enters into minor shirk. He said, similarly, seeking assistance from the jinn, because it is not something which has been established. It is not something established in the Sharia or other than it.
أيضا الرابع أن عالم الجن أخبرنا الله عز وجل أنهم يتسلطون على بني آدم أنهم يتسلطون على بني آدم فلا ينبغي فتح الباب حتى لا يتسلطوا على بني آدم نكتفي بهذا تفضل تفضل جزاك الله خير
إن شاء الله we'll continue.